interview with the candidate. Okay, guys, this is lecture number 9. Reinforced concrete videos or lectures that I'm giving. In number 8, in the previous video, we started the shear design. This one, we're going to continue or finish the shear design by solving this exam. This is actually one of the textbook problems. It's 512 with the 15th edition. The following information are given to you. You have a T-beam. All the dimensions are given and the reinforcement is given. It's reinforced with 6 number 10 in 2 rows. The overall depth, including the slab, which is the flange, is 35 inch. And the cover to the center of the 2 layers is 4 inch, or the distance to the center of the 2 layers is 4 inch. So it's giving you D equal 31 inch. F prime C is 5,000 psi or 5 psi. Fy is 60 psi. The beam is going to be simply supported span of 24 foot. The dead load and live load are uniformly distributed. The intensity of the dead load is 2.67 kip per foot. And the live load is 5.36 kip per foot. Both uniformly distributed. And these are the service loads. These are the service loads, including the self-weight of the T-beam. So the T-beam cross-section is given to you. The T-beam cross-section is given to you. If this one was part of a grid system given to you, you have to find this flange width, the effective flange width. But this cross-section is given to you, and they are asking you to design this T-beam. However, you can check to see if this one is smaller than the equations or the values we said, the lesser of the following for be effective. Anybody still remember that? Span over 4, right? One of them is span over 4. Span 24 divided by 4, that's 6, right? 6 for time 12, 72. So this is this. Or B width plus 16 HF. And if you multiply 16 times 6, it's way bigger than that. So this is still good. Or the distance between beam center line, which you have no information about. So this is kind of a cross-section of a T-beam for you to calculate the strength. Okay? Now this is designed for you, for flexure. It is designed for you. Okay? The question is, so this is given. The question is, design the shear reinforcement for that. Design the stirrups for this one. This is what we need to design. These stirrups. By the way, they are called web reinforcement. They are called web reinforcement because they are in the web. If you remember the formula for them, right? Remember the formula for BC? What? 2 square root of prime C. BWD. BWD. We don't consider this one in our calculation of the concrete contribution to the shear strength. Go ahead.
The stirrups, they always have hooks at the top.
Yeah.
Do we need rebar along the top to tie onto those?
Yeah, that's to hold it down. So usually you require one bar at each end so that you can hold them in this for constructability.
And we subtract that from the ASF wall?
No, we don't. That's called doubly reinforced T-beam. You don't have to consider them in your design. Why would you subtract them? Those, they give you extra strength. You don't include them in your calculation. They are kind of conservative. Mm-hmm. Remember for doubly reinforcement? We said you don't have to consider the compression steel if your raw is this that raw max. You don't have to consider them. If you consider them, you will get a little bit more strength. But the code allows you to analyze it as singly if raw is this that raw max. If your raw here is more than raw max, it's not allowed to solve it as single. Okay, so this is singly reinforced T-beam. We know most of the beams, they have steel at both sides, so both are double. But you don't have to consider them. They give you more strength. But you never subtract from this. Why would you subtract from this? This is what you have. You have something more, it gives you more compression. It means it's stronger. But we don't consider that. For constructivity, definitely you want to have this one. Okay, but they are in the compression zone, not required. They are there for constructability. And by the way, this hook here is to anchor those bars. Because those bars, they are in compression, right? They must be anchored, otherwise they're gonna buckle. Okay? Okay, guys. So this is what we have. I'm gonna use the other side to show you the, and this is, by the way, symmetric. So whatever we're gonna have in the design, or the stirrups design on the left would be the same as from the center line to the right. So I'm gonna show half of the beam there, and whatever you have on the left will be mirrored on the right. Okay, so I'm gonna use that thing for the final detailing of the beam. I'm gonna check also the strength before I go, just as a review for the flexural strength. Okay? So what's W ultimate? The first step is to calculate W ultimate, right? Calculate M ultimate, check if this section is good for bending, then calculate V ultimate and start design, right? So what's M ultimate, what's W ultimate for this one here? 1.2 dead, 1.6 line. So this will give you 1.2 times 2.67 plus 1.6 times 5.36. This gives the W ultimate equal 11.78 kip per foot. Simply supported beam with distributed load. So M ultimate equal what? W ultimate L square over 8 equal 11.78 times 24 square divided by 8. And M ultimate is
848
kip foot. That's a huge moment. You require a strong section, a big section like that for that. That's why the reinforcement here is heavy and the section is big. Okay, let's check. This is an ultimate. Does this section give you PMN or design strength more than that? Let's check. Sometimes you have a problem like that. It's telling you check the adequacy of this design. Okay? Check the adequacy of this design. Now, in T-beam analysis, the first thing we do is what? Is to calculate A to see if we can analyze it as rectangular cross section or T-beam analysis is needed. So we have to check A from top. If A is less than 6 inch, rectangular beam analysis. If A is more than 6 inch, it's a T-beam analysis. Let's see. A equal AS FY over 0.85 F prime C B effective, which is B flange here. You start when you check A from this side with this B. So you get, what's the area of 6 number 10, by the way, guys?
7.62
inches squared. This is the area of 6 number 10 bars. That's the area. Find 60 divided by 0.85 times 5. Because I'm using 60 kip, so I'm going to use F prime C 60 KSI, this is 5 KSI, times 42. So A equal what?
2.56.
2.56. Less than 6 inch rectangular. And you can find here C small equal A over beta 1. Equal 2.56 over what's beta 1?
0.8.
Why 0.8? Because F prime C is 5,000 psi. If it's this, that, is this or equal 4,000 psi, beta 1 is 0.85. Beta 1 decreased by 0.05 for every 1,000 psi increase in F prime C. And that's 1,000 increase, so it's going to 0.8. This would be a very small number here.
3.2
inch, and if you do C over DT, by the way, if you want to be accurate, and DT is you just basically add about 2 inch, because D is given to you 31 inch here, to the center of the box, DT is to the
center of the last row or layer of rebar. Anyway, if you do it C over D, you will be fine. So C over DT equal 3.2 divided by typically 33, if I assume 2 inch cover to the center, this will be very small number. How much?
0.097.
This is less than or equal 0.375. I know the T factor is 0.9. Guys, this is a typical problem you're going to expect in the exam. You're going to have a beam like that, or maybe just a drawn beam for you. I'm going to ask you, design this beam or check this beam for flexure. Design for shear. Calculate the deflection or check the deflection. Calculate the development length or a cutoff point. So that's a complete beam design.
You assume it's 2-inch cover, but shouldn't it be more than that because it's to the center of both steel beams?
No, the cover is to the center of this.
Oh, okay.
That's what's the cover. And by the way, this is a given information. Should be a given information. Just notice that the spacing between them, the spacing between the two layers or the two bars, should allow for at least 1 inch for the aggregate to go in there. The clear spacing.
I'm still confused on why we chose 42 for B effective. Shouldn't it be span over 4? Isn't it the greatest of all?
Do we have anything?
Well, span over 4.
What is it? 72 inch.
Yeah, 72 inch.
You have material here? Nothing. This is a section given to you. This is a cross-section given to you. They gave you this cross-section. Where are you going to bring something that you don't have?
I see.
If one of these things is less than that, it means you cannot take this one.
I see.
So this is an isolated T-beam. I don't want to talk about that.
Okay.
It's a T-beam that's given to you. Because for isolated T-beam, there are some requirements, how this one compared with that. But that's something given to you. If any of those three things, As I mentioned, span over 4, beam center line, between beam center line, 16 HF plus BW, is less than that, it means the effective is less than 42. Like if I give you this one to be 80 inch, you have to check against those. But for this one, typically this is way less than the three things. Now what's VMI? The design strength. Equal 0.9 times AS, which is 7.62, times 60 FY, times D, which is 31, minus A over 2. You have all the information. And this one you will get it, guys, in kip inch. You divide by 12 to get things in kip foot. How much, guys? Give the number.
I got a huge number.
Divide by 12.
1,053. Still a really big number.
It's not big. 1,000, you said? 53?
Yeah.
Okay, foot. That's what you get, guys. Yeah? Gerard, you got this number?
1,019.
I should make this the exam multiple choice, by the way. 1,019? Yep, foot. So, it's bigger than a mu. Okay, by the way, if it's too much bigger, you have to have another conclusion. Check 1,019 divided by what you need. This is what we need, 848. How much?
1.2.
So the design is 20% more than what you need. More than that is too much conservative. It's not economical. Within less than 20%, it's fine. If I do design, I will do less than 15%. But within 20%, we're still okay. More than 20%, you are wasting material. It's not economical. Okay? So this is check. Okay. The bending is good. Okay, guys? The question was not asking that. I just thought this one, so you review what we cover on flexion.
So if you got like more than 20, you should come back and get all the dimensions again.
No, if this is if the question was check, you say it's over designed. Or you say it's slightly over designed.
Okay, but what
if you say redesign on cutting the reinforcement, yeah, cut one bar and see. Cut one of the bars and see. You can say one bar.
So you don't have to change the dimensions of the beam, don't play with the
geometry unless you keep cutting in the bars such that you are less than raw minimum. Okay? The last thing you want to miss is the cross section. Okay? So you keep changing your bar. Unless you are going now less than raw minimum, then you say, okay, that's too much. I have to decrease that. I mean, even with raw minimum, I'm still getting more than what I need. So I have to decrease the concrete dimensions so that I can use something more than raw minimum. Okay? And by the way, you can check if you want rho from the beginning, rho, which is 7.62 divided by BWD, 14 times 31, it should be more than rho minimum. In rare situation, no way you will exceed rho max for T-beams. As I told you, rho max for T-beam, as we mentioned. You remember, Austin, what's rho max for T-beams? If you remember, it's good. If you don't, that's fine. It's rho max for singly plus rho flange. Remember, guys? And rho flange is ASF divided by BWD. It's way big, way big. Okay. So I have 11.78, right? So the reaction here and here, it's symmetric. The reaction here will be W ultimate times the length divided by 2. So this reaction is R equal W ultimate times L over 2 equal 11.78 times 24 divided by 2. Fast answers, guys. This is just everybody should have a calculator and doing this. Everybody. What's the answer?
141.
101?
141.
141. Okay. That's the reaction. That's the reaction. Let's draw now the shear diagram. Let's draw the shear diagram. It's important, guys, here. So this is 141. Okay? As you go from here, where are you going to go to? Minus 141. As I told you, it's symmetric. Straight line, by the way. This is 141. And this is 141. Okay. This is the shear diagram. And by the way, I'm going to assume the 4 inch. I mean, I have no information about the width of the support, the width of the column. Because remember, what is the critical section? Where is the critical section for shear? This is this concept, guys.
Wait.
Before you answer, if you don't answer this question, you have no clue what's shear design. So where is the critical section for shear?
Right off.
You have no clue what's shear design. D from where?
D
from face of support. That's the critical section for shear. If you don't memorize this one or you don't know it from now, you are clueless about shear design. There is where is the critical section? D from face of the support. Now in this problem, I have no clue about what's the width of the support, which is the column, typically. A column or a wall or whatever. Or sometimes can be a girder. This could be a floor beam and the support is a girder one. So I'm going to assume the 24 is from the face of the support. I'm going to assume the 24 from face of the support. Okay? What's D?
31 inches.
Given to you 31 inch. D is 31 inch. So D equal how many foot? 31 divided by 12.
2.58.
2.58?
Yeah.
Foot. Good. So you come here, this is this distance from here to here is how much?
12 feet.
So I'm gonna come at this small distance here, which is 2.58, this is D. Okay? Okay? I go up. This one here, to the left here, this one is, what do we call it?
Video bar.
This is what?
Video bar.
V bar U or V U bar, whatever you wanna say. V bar U. V bar U. That, what's V bar U? Is the shear at the critical section. Anyone in the world who work with reinforced concrete, if you tell him V bar U, they'll tell you that's the shear at the critical section. Whether in Brazil, whether in Spain, whether in Jordan, whether in USA, anyone, what's V bar U? It is the shear at the critical section. Why? Because the mother of every code in reinforced concrete design is the ACI code, is the American Concrete Institute 318. That's the mother of every code related to reinforced concrete design. Okay? And this is how they go, by the way. This is overseas. This is how they do it. Design according to the code of the country or equivalent ACI code. If you do the design according to the ACI 318, that's will do the job. Or their own code. Sometimes they customize it based on the material and the construction methods and all of that, and the steel they have. Go ahead.
So, from structural analysis, we know what the maximum shear is. If we design for V bar U, isn't the system under-designed when we look right off the support, when we look...
Okay, I know what's your question. You are saying the shear there...
is too much.
Wait, it's bigger than the shear here.
Yeah.
And you are saying, why would you design for this one, where the shear here is bigger? Why would you design for this? Now, I give one bonus point for whoever answered this thing. Why the critical section at D from face of the support? I'll tell you why. Have you ever hanged to a branch of a tree and break it? Doesn't break at the edge. It breaks away from the tree. You know why? Two reasons. Well, anyhow, before I give like one bonus point. What's the support here? Typically, what's the support? Column. What does it have? What's the load in the column?
Compression.
So we have compressive from the column. You know what does that mean? That the column provides confinement within D. The column confines the beam or whatever attached to it within this distance D because of the high compression there in the column. So that D is confined by the column. Although we provide stirrups there. Mm-hmm. But the most critical one is a D from face of the support.
Okay?
Good question. By the way, look, I will remind you of something else. The tensile test you did, you took a specimen like that, or if you did not do it, this is how we do it. We take a steel specimen, 0.5 inch diameter, we grab it with the machine, and we will apply direct tension, right? Right? That's how we do it. So all of that specimen has the same tensile, right? All of it. Why does it break in the middle? Why not here or here? If the material is pure, homogeneous material, why always break in the middle? Because of the confinement. The area that's most confined is with those. I'm confining this one. As you go far from the confinement, that's the least confined area, although all of them have the same force. Likewise in shear. Good? Yeah, okay, it's good to understand that it's good. If someone asks you in the feedback, why would you do that? This is the shear is higher. You should be able to answer him. You should be able to answer anyone who asks you this question. So that's our ultimate or shear at the critical section. And by the way, you have to do similar triangles here? You don't have to. If you know structural analysis and you listen to me, what I said in structural analysis, you don't have to. Guys, the shear, look, something easy in life. The shear is decreased by W ultimate for every foot. Every foot you walk, you go down 11.78. How many foot we went to get the bar unit? 2.58. So this number will be 141 minus 2.58 times 11.78. You have to do similar trainings and make a mistake in there. You don't have to. So you see the physical meaning. I know, okay. The slope of the shear is the intensity of the distributed load. It means every foot I go, there's a drop of W ultimate in the shear. That's what does it mean. Okay, if you want to do similar triangles, that's fine. Sometimes I'm telling you, you don't have to. So V bar U equal 141 minus 2.58, which is D, times W ultimate, which is 11.78. And V bar U will be, what's guys?
110.6.
See the difference now? It's worth it sometimes in deep sections. It's worth it to design it. It's more economical. Instead of designing for 141 kip, now you can design only for 1 or 111. Okay. Good? Okay. Now, what's now the first step you do to see if the concrete is good or not? Maybe the concrete by itself will be able to handle this. So you calculate what? VC or phi VC. You calculate phi VC because phi is 0.75. So phi VC equal 0.75 times 2 square root of half prime C, you plug it, 5,000, as I keep saying, times BWD times 14 times what? 31. This will be in pound. You divide by 1,000 to get it in kip. So phi VC equal
46.
Huh?
46.
46? Kip. That's your phi VC. 46 kip. And so it's obvious that we need to design shear stirrups. Concrete is not enough at all. So we said now, in shear design, we have three regions, right? We have three regions. One region, shear is small. The theory says, when the shear is less than that, you don't need stirrups. That's the theoretical calculation. The concrete is enough. The ACI code says no, and we follow the ACI code. He said, shear stirrups are not needed when V ultimate is less than VVC over 2. So what's VVC over 2? Equal 23 kip. When V ultimate is less than this number here, when the shear keep dropping, the shears keep dropping, okay? When it's no longer this number here, no stirrups is needed. Now you can say, okay, I'm gonna go the other way, Benson, right? Because the shear here is zero, right? This increased by 11.78 for every foot you go. This line is just a line, man. Yeah. The slope of this line is W, which is 11.78. So the shear here is zero. It's gonna keep going here, right? So at what distance am I gonna reach 223 kip? Which is 23 divided, what, how you did it? Which is 23 divided by 11.78. So how much that distance?
Your inches or feet?
In feet, everything in feet.
1.95.
So he's saying at 1.95, you know, I don't wanna, just to be a little bit to scale, my best. 1.95, he said at this distance here, he calculated VU here equal 23 kip. So from within the middle 4 feet, almost within the middle 4 feet, we need stirrups. 1.95 from here and 1.95 from here. No stirrups are needed, right? No stirrups are needed. Now, where is the location of VVC? Twice this, right? Twice this. This is VU equal 46.
46.
46 Kelvin. In this region here, no stirrups. In the first one. Second one, that's how you do it. S max. You don't have to write so many language, the maximum stirrup spacing is needed. S max will do the job. S max there. Now what's S max? There's a check you need to do, right? What's that check? Who still remember?
Find ES.
You need to check what?
ES
against?
BC.
Against BC. So the check would be against BC, which is 4BC.
Okay.
Yeah, there is 2VC, there is no VBC in there.
Check where it's spacing.
4.76 inch. That's how much you need. Okay? That's the required spacing at the critical section here. That's a small spacing compared with the 15.5. Okay? So again, you will not get something like that. You can say use 4.75. You can round this number to 4 inch, 3/4 inch. Or 4.5, that should be fine. We don't want to round this one to a full number, 4, because this is big. You cannot round it up. You don't want to go all the way 3/4 inch. Although you can. Many engineers in the field, in the practice, they will use 4. They will use 4 at the critical section. Okay? So we'll use 4.5 inch. Okay? I'll use 4.5 inch. If the question was to you, use one spacing in this zone, done. You're done. If the question was to you, use at least 2 spacing, you need to come up with another spacing. What you need to check now? Which? The second one. Which? How much will you go? The minimum, I mean, you need the maximum or the smallest spacing you need is 4.5. That can be good up to here. I mean, when in some location here, the 9 or 8 or 10 will be enough, or the 7. Mm-hmm. At some here, some location here, whatever you get from 8 inch or 10 inch or 7 inch or 8 inch will be good enough. So you pick one. Usually we pick something that's double what you use there, cutting it by half. Or you, now, I'll show you again. These numbers, if you don't do detailing, they mean nothing. The guys are clueless, I told you. You need to tell them, this is the cross section. This is where you put the first stirrup. Up to this one, that's how many stirrups you have. Then you do that, that and that. Good? So now, try 8 inch. Where? Up to where? How you do it?
Find VS.
Find VS that you can get with 8 inch. Add it to VC, multiply it by the V factor, you get that thing. Come to here with similar triangle, you get the location. You get the location. Again, if I use 8 inch, what's the VS that I will get? Reverse it with this. V is not going to be V bar S, it's going to be VS. Why? Because the term bar, we use it at the critical section. So with 8 inch, he's saying VS equal how much?
51.
51 Kelvin, which is 122 times 60 times 31 over 8.
Yep.
Okay. So what is the location in the beam that will give me 51? Okay, it's easy. Again, this is zero reference. This one decreased by 11.78. So if you divide 51 by 11.78, that will give you how many feet you have from the middle.
Mm-hmm. 4.3.
Four, just 4.3?
4.33.
From here? Not worth it.
Boy, that's barely more than the last.
What?
4.3.
From here. This is the 51 here.
If we start at zero and have from
here. It's almost what it be.
Not.
Because for BC is 46. And the one we got this BS is 51, so the difference.
What's that? Again?
The 8 is in inches, right?
8 inches.
And that is
11
feet, right?
No, 4.5 inches.
Let's have this is the spacing. This is the spacing in this equation, S.
Yes.
So you calculated the bar S done, you are done.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wait a minute.
That's what I'm saying, because that is 12.
Wait a minute.
That's good.
Still, not done. Now, what's phi? PV M. For this, it's 0.75 times 51 plus 46. Now, again, you need to know how much, because not only the stirrups will give you the strength here, it's the stirrups plus the concrete. So it's VVC plus VS. So how much this number now? How much?
73 kilo.
Now you come to your shear diagram and you locate where is the 73 is at. You understand, guys?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not checking on the shear diagram VS. I'm checking VVC, sorry, VVN, which is VVS plus VC. So now we need, where is the location that will give me?
6.2.
73. He's saying, this is from here, is
6.2.
So within this region here, which is going to be 6.2 minus that thing here, and I can start the spacing of 8 from here. All the way to here, then I have the 15, then I have nothing in there, and go. From here to here, I will go with the 4.5. But if you do that, you may enter some of the layers. So let's do it here. The layout or the detailing. Let's do the detailing. So let's say this is 12 foot. The beam is 24. This is 12 foot. Now, we said where we put the first stirrup? 2 inch from the face of the support. Where is the steel? The steel is embed the steel in this one. By the way, this is simply supported beam. It means this joint is bent. It means this joint is bent. The code requires this part to be embedded here by 6 inch at least. We're gonna get this one in the development link, but this one is at least 6 inch. Forget it, it's not a part of our design. So where are we gonna put our, and you expect to have compression steel at the top for constructability. So now we have the stirrups. Now we have the stirrups. What is, we put the first stirrup, we said 2 inch from the face of the support. not from the rotor, sorry. The stirrups goes all just to the level of the steel. It holds the steel. So that's how you see the stirrup. That's the first one. Okay? That's the first one. We said, so this, you said this is 6.2. Mm-hmm. And 6.2 minus this number in here, minus 2 times that.
Two point three.
Okay. Now, do I care about this one, D now, anymore? Nope, wait. I designed based on D bar U here. So what do I do, what do I use from? 2 inch from the face of the support to D, which is 2.58. The spacing I calculated at D. So I start my spacing from here. So what's that distance here? What's the distance here? It's 12 minus 2 inch, right? The distance here, this distance from here to the 2 inch from face of the support is 12 minus 6 minus face of what? Minus 2 inch.
Okay.
So 12 times 144, 12 times 12, that's 144. Minus 2, sorry, again. It's 12 minus 6.2. In feet, multiply them by 12, then subtract 2 inch.
It's 67.6 inches.
67 point what?
6 inches.
67.6 inches. Divide by 4.75 or 4.5?
15.02.
15, almost exact.
How many stirrups do I need, or how many spacings do I need? 15.
16.
I need? Mm-hmm. 15. It's a 15.2 or something.
No, it's 16.
But 16 stirrups.
But 16 stirrups. The first one is there. Now you need 15 spacing. To make 15 spacing, you need 16 stirrups. Okay? And this distance from here to there, again, I have to show it. Is it almost half of it, right?
Yeah.
Almost. This distance from here to here is. We'll see. We will see how much we can go. But that will do it exactly, right? That will go exactly right there. So this one is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Spacing. If you do it in AutoCAD, you know how to do array, right? Mm-hmm. Array at 4.5, everything to scale. AutoCAD, everything to scale. By the way, if there is a mistake in the dimension or in the detailing, the guy use the scale to verify things. Sometimes you have someone is telling some you something doesn't make sense to you. Then okay, everything should be to scale because this, at the bottom or the right bottom corner of the sheet, it says the scale, right? So you can take that scale with whatever scale written and measure. Okay. So this is here. What we're gonna say here in this one, we're gonna say 16 number 3 stirrups is that enough? That should be enough, but at 4.5 inch. At 4.5 inch.
You don't say outside?
That's it. Sentence, very small. It's not at something. Okay? But we have 16 pieces. Now from here to 2.3, we said we're gonna use 8. So I have one right there. If I use 8, so 2.3 is how many inch?
47.
Divided by 8.
3.5.
3.5. We're going to use 4. Mm-hmm. So we're going to use 4 spacing. 2, 3, 4. Now what you do, 4 times 8. Mm-hmm. 32. Times, divided by 12.
2.67.
So that distance here will go up to 2.67. By the way, this distance is how many, was it? This is all exact.
5.8.
It's almost, how much?
5.8, I know.
This one is 5.8. There's 2 inch at the end. This is almost 6.
So it's 67.6 inches.
67, you said?
67.6.
From the 2 inch or from the face?
That's only 5.6 feet. It's only 5.5 feet.
Yeah, but because we're thinking in like the 2 inches.
But that's where we need. That's how much we need.
67.6.
Let's say 68 to the end.
You would go something like that. Well.
Now, this one is 32 inch. What's left? Add them together. Add them. And divide by 12.
8.3 feet.
8.3. Subtract them from 12.
Or 8.5. Because 8.5. You have the 2 inches at the beginning.
Oh, because we still have the 2 inches?
Okay. So how much you have again?
Basically 3.6
feet. 3.5
feet. 3.5 feet? Okay, wait a minute. I have to, guys, show this a little bit more so we can tell that we increase the spacing, kind of. This is, would be like that. This distance will be up to here. What do you write here?
5.
Let's say 5 or 4, given that this one, 5
at 4.
Number 3 at
8.
Okay? Assuming that there are 5 starting from this distance. But this one is count here and here.
Okay.
That's fine. Or you can say, look, number 3 at 8. That will do it. Number 3 at 8 will do it in this region. So if you have one here already, you don't count. Okay. Now, what's from here to here? We said there is?
That's max.
So we know from the middle now, you go to the middle one, which is? We know this one. How many inch? 1.95 times? Times 12, which is?
23.5.
23 inch. Don't count the 23.5. So within the first 23.5, you don't need it. Say 23. So how much left? 144 minus that, minus that, minus that, should give you what?
21.
How many stirrups? How was the spacing? 15. The maximum spacing is 15. So you just need one stirrup here. And one will go in here. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Number 3 at 15. Here, no stirrups needed. Always add one in the middle for constructivity. Always put one in the middle for constructivity. Okay? Always put one in the middle. You don't want this distance here to be like 4 feet without any shear stirrup. So we always here. And some by the way, I don't want to go into that. Sometimes, if you assume the live load is not going to be on the full span, you will develop shear in the middle, by the way.
Okay, so that's what I'm going to ask. You want to put a stirrup in the very middle at the point of zero shear?
Yeah, but you may have, I said, I don't need it. For constructability, to hold the bars together.
Oh,
to hold these bars, they are heavy bars. So the bars will not wobble or sag down. Just for constructability, not for strength. But I said, if you change the location of the line load, you may end up with shear in the middle. You load half of the beam with live load, you can check it. You're gonna get shear in the middle. But usually that shear is small compared with the PVC by itself. And what you have for constructivity. Usually it's, that's why sometimes when we draw the shear diagram, we don't draw the shear diagram for fixed load. We say draw the envelope. you will maximize the load. You'll get all of these things.
If you look at all these stirrups, they're standing straight up like this, but they all have that same width of 0.11 inches. So if we add that up, that actually is adding 3 inches of area of steel, right?
It's very small. This is to the center. This is to the center.
Very small.
Okay. This is to the center. All these distances to the center of the stirrup. Okay. These stirrups are very small.
Okay.
And usually require.
They would never increase our strength.
Logistics here are different. We go overseas. I ask the students to go to the field, go to any floor detailing, and design those beams. Take pictures, redesign them, and make sure what they have there is correct in terms of and in terms of cross-section, and in terms of that. But I know here to access any site, there's a lot of logistics, a lot of things. It's hard to do. But anyone who's taking this one must go to the field and see what's steel. Just go to a factory. Okay? Where are the steel? How you do the beams? How you do the stirrups? The guys here, you know, the stirrups are so easy to do. Once you tell them, here, what's the geometry? They have machines. They run them so fast. They will ship them to you, like 1,000 or 2,000. They will calculate. You will have an engineer telling you what to order. He will tell you, okay, for this, the steel doesn't come maybe in that much length. So what to do? Sometimes you need to splice them. He'll tell you, order that many numbers, or this, by the way, it's sold by pound. By ton. That's how they sell you. By pound or whatever, you know, that's how they sell you. And they can cut anything for you on their own. Unless you want to hook it, then that's a different cost. But for cutting, they just run them and cut them. So easy to do. The shear here, the shear is costly. The shear stirrups are costly. Not only costly in terms of fabrication, also in terms of putting them into the beam. So that's why sometimes some of the research is to cut the spacing by adding fiber to the concrete. By adding some structural fiber to the concrete, you may end up with improving the performance. Why? Because we are afraid, why shear in concrete design is scale or something? Why the code would require at PVC over 2? As I told you, PVC should be good because of the sudden failure, the brittle and failure nature of shear failure. It's brittle, it's sudden. So sometimes when you have these fibers, even if there's a failure on the concrete, the fibers will bridge these failures and the concrete will remain intact. There will be no problem, no falling, no sudden thing. That's an area of research. This maximum, there's some modification or some limitations on the spacing, the maximum spacing for shallow beams, for the beams with very small depth. We're talking about within less than, let's say, 8 inch to 10 inch. This maximum spacing requirement may be relaxed. Relaxed, it means they may give you a room to use more than the over 2. They tell you, okay, you can use up to 3D over 4. Something like that. Okay? In no case, they will let you use D. Unless it becomes so shallow, what does that become? A slab. That becomes a slab. We use no shear stirrups in slab design. That's the easy thing in design of slabs. No shear stirrups is used. Derek, how are you going to put them in slab? So the concrete develop all the necessary shear strength requirement to resist the shear forces in a slab. And one-way slab, by the way, it's a beam. One-way slab is a beam with width 1 foot. So this is a slab. Consider we have beams 1 foot wide. Put them side by side. That's a slab, right? It's continuous, but this is how we slab. We take 1 foot segment and we put them next to each other. So you take whatever load you have per square foot, you multiply it by 1 to get the load per feet on the strip, on the slab strip. Calculate the moment, calculate the shear, and design the slab. Then we see design of one-way slab. Some books, they cover them with the design of beams. One-way slab are covered with the design of beams. The only difference is no shear stirrups are needed. It's kind of, by the way, the slab, some people, they look at it as a footing. And there's no shear stirrups needed in the footing. Okay? The depth by itself, the concrete must develop the necessary shear strength. So that's why the width, the depth of the footing is determined based on what? You take foundation?
On the bearing.
Wait, did you take foundation?
No.
Okay. You did not, but they did.
Yeah.
You took foundation. Did you determine the width, the area of that footing, right? You took shallow foundation? shallow footing, you took it, right? Mm-hmm. So the bearing capacity, you have the load in the column, you use service load, you calculate the area, right? And that's how much the area. Let's say you have 6x6. That's the area. Then you do the ultimate load, then you calculate the depth, then you design the reinforcement. Did something like that, Ryan? You did? Gerard? You determine the D, the depth. Yes, then what? Yes, you took it.
I mean, the depth.
How we determine the depth of the footing? What? Something makes sense to me, you know, you said. Bezun shear.
Because how much?
Bezun shear. Now, listen. There's two types of shears in footings. What are they?
Good job.
There are two types of shear in footings.
Depends on how much soil.
And when I say spread footing, that's familiar to you, right? You have the square footing, there's the rectangular footing, there is the combined. Okay, they are not deep foundation, not piles. There is something called one-way shear, and there's something called two-way shear, right? There's something called bunching shear, and there's something called beam shear. You hear something like that? The bunching shear? No?
We just did
one-way shear.
So you guys need to take it again. If you don't know how to do that, it means there's something wrong. The shear design controls the depth of the footing. Once you have the width from the bearing capacity, from the soil report, that determines the area. The shear design determines the depth. So you have it ready. What's left? Steel. How much steel to put in there? Based on flexural design. Okay. Why? Because the depth by itself should give you enough shear capacity. You don't need stirrups in foundation. Look at the footing as a slab, but flip it upside down. If you flip the footing, you will have the footing at the top and the column at the bottom. So it's like inverted slab. Some people look at the slab like that. Okay? Is it time?
15 minutes.
Okay, any question? That will do it for shear design. Next lecture I'm gonna start with serviceability. Serviceability. Flexion, crack control.